Hello students, today we'll see the next topic in the diamorphin and heroin. In the previous lecture we have discussed about bulk and trace analysis of heroin. Then we have seen the various presumptive testing such as a color test and all that. Then we have discussed about the thin layer chromatography. Now we'll discuss about the next topic, that is the identification of heroin by GCMS. Then after that we'll discuss about the quantification of heroin, and then we'll see about the quantification of heroin by GC. So first, gas chromatographic mass spectrometric identification of heroin. So the opiate drugs will chromatograph in both the daratized and undaratized form. So first of all, what is the need to daratize the given compound in while analyzing the GC? So generally what happens in case of GC, the sample to be analyzed should be volatile in nature, and hence whenever the sample is volatile, at that time we can have proper analysis with the GC or GCMS. But generally what happens in case of opiates, we have to perform the analysis by daratized and undaratized form also. So this is because these both the compounds, they are volatile in nature, and that's why we have analyzed both the forms. So in undaratized drugs, 3 hydroxide moieties are present in a 6-O monoacetyl morphine and codeine. So these form hydrogen bonds with the analyte molecules and soft strongly onto the various components of the gas chromatographic system. So these hydrogen bonds are sufficiently strong that they cause problems such as the tailing of the compound, and as a consequence, daratization of the drug is advised. Okay, so due to that interaction of hydrogen bonds with the chromatographic column, there is a tailing is occurred, and that's why there is a need to daratize the given compound. So in addition to improving the chromatographic properties of the analyte, daratization prevents the phenomenon of transacetylation, which has been observed when injections of unaratized drug have been made into the chromatographic system when methanol is used as a solvent. So whenever methanol is used as a solvent, at that time there is a possibility of acetylation is going to be taken place, and hence to avoid that, daratization is must. So stages involved in the identification of heroin by GCMS. So the first, the sample is prepared in a suitable solvent, that is one which is volatile, free of water, does not react with analytes or catalyze their decomposition, and in which the analyte is are freely soluble. The sample solutions in centrifuge to remove any solid material which might block the syringe or components of the gas chromatography system. The supernatant is then used for the subsequent analysis. So here what we have to get a clear solution for the analysis by GC. So for that we have either performed the centrifugation or by collecting the supernatant as a sample. The standards are prepared at a concentration of the same order of the magnitude as the sample. Okay, so standard must be prepared in the concentration of the sample. A solvent blank is also prepared for the analysis. The samples and standards are placed in the GC vials and blown down under the nitrogen flow. The latter gas is used to prevent the sample decomposition. So nitrogen is preventing the decomposition of the sample. Then in the next stage, the daratization reagent, that is 100 microliter of 10% NOPSA in hexane containing 0.1 mg per ml of the N-alkane as the Indian standard is to be added to the sample, and the sample vials are closed, the system shaken, and then allowed to daratize at room temperature. The sample is then analyzed in the following order. First, we have to inject the daratized blank, then daratized standard, then daratized blank, again daratized sample, and then daratized blank, etc. So in this manner we can analyze the given sample by using GC in this following sequence. So this is the table 1 in which they have provided the typical GC operating conditions and parameters for the analysis of opiate drugs by GC, FID or GC, MS. So the first column is a OV1 having 25 meter length and 0.22 mm of internal diameter, having a particle size of 0.5 micron. Injection temperature, it is about 250 degrees Celsius. Then column mount temperature, it is about 150 degrees Celsius for 2 minutes and increase to 280 degrees Celsius at 9 degrees Celsius per minute rate. And held the temperature for the 2 minutes. And carrier gas here we have used is helium at the flow rate of 1 ml per minute. Split ratio is 50:1. As the concentration is optimum, that's why we have to maintain the split ratio is 50:1. Then detector, generally flame ionization detector or mass spectrometric detector are generally used. Then detector temperature is about 290 degrees Celsius and deratizing reagent it is NO, bis trimethyl xylene acetamide. That is a BSA, trimethyl xylene acetamide, bis trimethyl xylene acetamide. Typically, a temperature program is used to separate the analytes. So, an example of typical conditions such as we have discussed in the table 1. Although it should be remembered that there will be the variation between different laboratories and different instruments in use. So, this is because if you consider every instrument and every laboratory having different kinds of specification corresponding to that instrument, when the make of the instrument is changed, then some other parameters will also be changed, such as the RF value or retardation factors. Our retention time is also changed, and that's why there is a somewhat variation would be occurred while analyzing the sample. A typical chromatographic secretion is presented in the figure 1, let us see in the next slide. So the compounds are identified by the GCMS analysis on the basis of the two pieces of the information, namely the retention time or relative retention index and the mass spectral data. So the values of the relative retention index calculated as a follow. So retention time of the compound divided by the retention time of the internal standard, it will give rise to the relative retention index for the given sample. So let us see the figure 1, which will indicate the different opiate derivatives which are present in the sample. So they are, so there is a separation of opiate derivatives with opiate derivatives with the NOBIS trimethyl xylyl acetamide by GCMS. So the first peak which is appear. It is corresponding to the codeine. Second, it is corresponding to acetylcholine. Third is corresponding to morphine. Fourth is corresponding to 6-monoacetylmorphine. Fifth is corresponding to dimorphine. Sixth is corresponding to papaverine. Seven, it is noscapine. Eight, it is caffeine. So C22 indicates the internal standard. Here we have used the internal standard, that is the N-alkene, that is the C22. Okay. And typically a temperature program is used to separate this kind of analytes of interest. Okay, so this is about the gas chromatographic mass spectrometry identification of drug. Then for each of these components of the drug sample are compared with those of the standards in a standard mixture. If the components in the drug and specific standard have the same retention index, then match is inferred. The mass spectra of the two compounds are subsequently compared, since in principle under a given set of mass spectroscopic conditions, every compound will fragment in a unique and predictable way. If the mass spectra matches, then the identity of the compound is considered to be proven or it is confirmed that there is a given compound. So the examples of mass spectra of dimorphine from the standard mixture and from the street sample of heroin, you will see in the next slide. So however, it should be remembered that when chromatographing NOBSA derivative, the mass spectra should be compared to those of the standard which have been derivatized in the same way and not with the spectrum of native. Right. So look at this particular figure 2. In the figure A, there is a standard sample is there, which is derivatized with the NOBSA, and second one, it is the actual sample. Okay, here we have water, heroin. So this is the two different peaks, that is the 369, then 377. So these are the two different peaks. It will indicate that there is a presence of heroin in the given sample. Then next one is the quantification of the heroin samples. So the opiate drugs present in the heroin can be quantified by using either GC or HPLC. When GC is used, sample is often derivatized. The quantification when using process makes the assumption that the sample has been completely and quantitatively derivatized. Such a treatment also precludes problems which is associated with the transacetylation if the drug are not treated in this way. In addition, however, the derivatization process adds further steps to the analysis that can result in the sample breakdown or contamination. So it is for these reasons that some laboratories carry out identification of heroin by using CCMS and quantify the sample by employing HPLC. So the examples of quantification using both GC and HPLC are discussed in the following sections. So the first, quantification of heroin by GC. In this example, a gas chromatographic analysis was performed to determine the quantity of the dimorphine in an illicit sample. The calibration data obtained are presented in the table 2. The sample was dissolved at a concentration of 1 mg per ml in the suitable solvent. From the result obtained, let us see in the table 3 in the next slide, it is possible to determine the quantity of the dimorphine present in this sample and provide the answer to the percentage basis. However, in order to establish that it is valid to use such a data, a graph must first be plotted, and by using that plotted graph, we can have an idea about the sample. The latter should be in the form of relative response, that is the peak area of the dimorphine. It is the ratio of peak area of the dimorphine with the peak area of the inference standard against the drug concentration. So the data required for such a plot are given in the table 4 with the resulting graph, which is shown in the figure number 3. So look at this particular table number 2, which shows the calibration data obtained by the GC analysis used for the determination of dimorphine in the heroin sample. So this is we have performed the analysis in duplicate manner. So we have to get the peak area of the two different times whenever the dimorphine concentration is defined. Then internal standard having area somewhat different. So these are the calibration data we are getting after the performing the replicate determination. Then the table number 3 shows the data obtained by the GC analysis of the heroin sample used for the determination of the dimorphine. Here we have the area in the arbitrary units for the particular determination of dimorphine. Then, using this data, it is possible to formulate the regression equation by employing the method of least squares and solving the following simultaneous equation. So look at this equation. Summation of y is equals to m into summation of x plus nc. It's also written as summation of xy equals to m into summation of x square plus c into summation of x. So the summed values are shown in the next table, and when these values are substituted into the above equations and the latter solved, the regression equation y is equals to 1.168 into x plus 0.007 is obtained. So this is nothing but the equation of the straight line, that is y is equals to mx plus c. In order to obtain the concentration of the drug, the ratios of the responses, that is the GC peak areas, are calculated for the two replicates. We have already seen the table number 4, giving the values of 0.406 and 0.401 respectively. So these are then averaged into 0.4035, and this value is then substituted into the regression equation, giving the concentration of 0.34 mg per ml. Expressing this as a percentage of the original concentration, that is 1 mg per ml, yields a final volume of 34%. So the no correction for the salt or free base is required in this evaluation. Look at this is the calibration curve used for the determination of the dimorphine in the heroin sample. Here we have used the different concentrations, and according to that we have get a different kinds of peak area corresponding to this, and by using this we have to find out the R square, that is a linear regression coefficient R square we have to find out. So this is the calibration data for the particular determination of dimorphine in the heroin sample whenever we have performed the replicate measurement for the quantification. Here we have performed the replicate measurement, and accordingly there is a change in the peak area. Here also the peak area of the entrance standard and Y values we have getting that are quite closer with respect to each other. Okay, and by using this we have to quantify the particular heroin sample by using the GC in the dimorphine content. Okay, so this is all about the quantification. The next we have to see we have to see about the quantification by the